Hello, welcome. Thank you for tuning in for my presentation today. I am Katarzyna Anna Kapitan. I'm postdoctoral research fellow at the Museum of National History at Frederiksborg Castle in Denmark, at the National Museum of Iceland and the University of Iceland. My talk today is a presentation of a brand new research project. And even though I highly regret that we cannot meet in person in Copenhagen and catch up over a cup of coffee, I am truly delighted to be able to present this research project to such a broad international audience of the virtual current conservation. So I hope you're gonna enjoy my presentation and that we're gonna have some fruitful discussions through Discord or during the live session on the 16th of April. My presentation today consists of three parts. I will start with introducing the figure of Torfæus, an Icelander employed as the royal antiquarian at the Danish court, who is responsible for creating the library I'm interested in. Then I'll talk a little bit about the library he created and why it is so interesting as a research subject. And finally, I will introduce the main objectives of my project, so the digital reconstruction of Torfæus's library. Let me start by presenting the main star of my talk today, Thormodus Torfæus. In the second half of the 17th century, a young Icelander called Þormóður Torfason was appointed as a royal antiquarian at the court of the Danish king Frederick III. His first assignment was to translate into Danish language various Old Norse-Icelandic sagas preserved in one of the manuscripts that the king received only a few years earlier from the Icelandic bishop Brynjólfur Sveinsson. Probably at that time, no one expected that this young man from the distant island in the middle of North Atlantic will become one of the most important historians of the early modern kingdom of Denmark and Norway. Þormóður Torfason, probably better known under his Latinized name, Thormodus Torfæus, was born in Iceland in 1636. But he studied at the University of Copenhagen in Denmark, and it was Copenhagen where he eventually found an appointment in the service of the Danish king, and where his scholarly career kick-started. The translations of the sagas that Torfæus prepared for Frederick III were never published, and they survive only in manuscript form, held today at the Royal Danish Library in Copenhagen. They consist of four splendid leather-bound volumes in folio format. The front cover of each volume is decorated with the gilded royal cipher of Frederick III, and the outer edges of the leaves are also gilded, indicating the prestigious status of these manuscripts. What I find quite interesting is that on the title page of the first volume, Torfæus plays the famous quote from Cicero's De Oratore. And you can see the quote on the right-hand side of the slide, and I'm going to read the English translation. History is truly the witness of times past, the light of truth, the life of memory, the teacher of life, and the messenger of antiquity. This might be seen as an indication that Torfæus actually treated the sagas he translated as historical sources. And as I hope to show in the course of my presentation today, his further work suggests that it was actually the case. Probably as a result of his work on the translations of Old Norse sagas into Danish, the young Torfæus noticed that the royal genealogies as presented in Icelandic sources diverge from the established succession presented by the medieval historian Saxo Grammaticus in his monumental work on Danish history called Gesta Danorum. According to Saxo Grammaticus, the Danish royal lineage can be traced back to the legendary king Dan. But according to Icelandic tradition, it can be traced back to the legendary king Skjöld. This did not escape the attention of meticulous Torfæus, who mentioned these discrepancies to King Frederick III, and the king ordered him to compile an account of genealogies based on Icelandic sources. This enterprise resulted in the Series Dynastarum et Regum Danie, or Succession of Rulers and Kings of Denmark. The first printed publication which openly broke with the Danish royal lineage established by Saxo Grammaticus. Torfæus completed his work in 1664 when he presented to the king the beautiful handwritten volume in quarto format that you can see on this slide. This manuscript today is held at the Royal Danish Library in Copenhagen, where it can be admired in its whole beauty. Aesthetically, it looks a lot like the volumes with his translations of Old Norse sagas, and it is also in the leather binding with the royal cipher of Frederick III on the cover and the gilded edges. This remarkable compilation, however, did not make it to the press for quite some time. Almost 40 years passed between the completion of this work in 1664 and its publication in 1702, when a highly revised version of the treatise was printed in Copenhagen. We can only speculate whether the controversial contents of this volume, breaking with the traditional succession of Danish rulers established by Saxo, had anything to do with the delay between the completion of the work and its publication. But from the scholarly correspondence between Torfæus and his younger colleague, Árni Magnússon, we can assume that it might have been the case. When Árni Magnússon, the famous Icelandic book collector and the founding father of the Arnamagnæan collection, was discussing the publication of the Series Dynastarum with Torfæus, he considered its contents problematic and thought that it could be banned. In a letter from the 2nd of October 1700, Árni wrote to Torfæus about the expected reception of the volume by the Danish audience. You can see the quote on this slide together with English translation, and I'm just going to read the English translation. So Árni wrote, "They would consider it inappropriate that we, Danes, should give others pretext to disbelieve Saxo. It crossed my mind that it could happen that your publication would be banned, even though it is censored." Whether the contents of Series Dynastarum had anything to do with the winding course of Torfæus's scholarly career remains again a matter of speculation. Shortly after the completion of the Series Dynastarum, Torfæus lost his office at the Danish court and was sent to Norway. 3 years later, in 1667, he received another appointment as the royal antiquarian, but his office did not last for long, as it was not renewed after Frederick III's death in 1670. Torfæus had to wait to regain his office until much later. First in 1682, he was appointed by Christian V of Denmark as the historiographer of the Kingdom of Norway, and he received one main assignment from the king: to write a complete history of Norway in Latin. It was during his time in Norway when Torfæus started building his library of Old Norse texts. And this takes me to the second part of my presentation, in which I will focus on the library. Even though Torfæus borrowed some manuscripts from the Royal Library and took them with him to Norway, he had to rely on his scholarly network to obtain access to various Old Norse Icelandic texts that were relevant for his work of royal historiographer. He corresponded extensively with his friends and acquaintances in Iceland and beyond to build his library of relevant Old Norse sources. On this slide, you can see one of the letters in which Torfæus asked his friend in Iceland, Reverend Torvi Jonsson, for copies of some sagas. He says that he needs them to conduct his research into Danish and Norwegian genealogies. Even though he has never seen some of these texts, based on his knowledge, he still considered them potentially relevant for his research. This is quite important insight into Torfæus' interests and his approach into Icelandic literature as historical sources. It allows us to ask questions about his scholarly interests, such as which texts he was interested in obtaining and how he used them. To answer these research questions, we need to look not only at Torfæus' correspondence, but also at the manuscripts he collected and commissioned. During his long academic career, Torfæus collected and commissioned multiple volumes of transcriptions of Old Norse Icelandic texts. The preserved manuscripts bear witness to his scholarly interests and his working methods as a historian, but they have never been systematically studied and analyzed. Many of his marginalia clearly show his historical interest in the genealogies of the legendary kings of Scandinavia. Because of these, Torfæus paid great attention to the intertextual connections between various Old Norse texts and the inaccuracies that appear in them. On this slide, you can see a note in which Torfæus comments on the genealogies presented in the text of one legendary saga and compares them to the ones presented in another legendary saga. Neither saga would be seen as a historical source today, as the Icelandic legendary sagas are generally seen as works of literary fiction, but apparently, at Torfæus' time, they were perfectly suitable for historical research. His library consists of all sorts of texts, including transcripts of medieval law books and chronicles, as well as saga literature. Not only the Old Norse Icelandic king's sagas, but also the sagas of Icelanders, bishop sagas, and the legendary sagas. According to my preliminary research, we have today at least 130 individual texts preserved, which were either commissioned or collected by Torfæus. They are preserved in two repositories in Iceland and Denmark, and they are collected under 103 individual shelf marks. What is intriguing, however, is that these 103 shelf marks do not correspond to 103 books that Torfæus owned, and they are nowhere near to the state of the actual library of Torfæus. It turns out that texts which used to be in a single codex in Torfæus' library today survive in many independent parts held in two different countries, so that their contents can no longer be seen in their entirety. For example, Codex 16 in folio, which in Torfæus' library used to contain 10 texts, today is preserved in 5 separate parts, 2 of which are held in Copenhagen in Denmark and 3 in Reykjavík in Iceland. 3 of these manuscripts are single text codices, and only AM157H folio and AM6 folio contain more than one text. On this slide, you have an overview of what happened to these manuscripts, with green fields representing the manuscripts which are in Copenhagen, and the blue fields represent the manuscripts which are in Iceland, in Reykjavík. So, how did it happen that this single manuscript got divided into so many smaller units? Well, it is quite a long story, but I'll try to be brief here. After Torfæus' death in 1719, a large part of his library of Old Norse Icelandic texts ended up in the possession of Árni Magnússon, the famous Icelandic manuscript collector based in Copenhagen. Árni was not only manuscript collector interested in preservation of the cultural heritage, but also a philologist interested in editing and publishing Old Norse Icelandic texts. Even though he has never edited anything himself, his collection bears traces of some editorial interest he had, which also determined the way he interacted with his manuscripts. As the recent research done by Beke Stegmann here at the University of Copenhagen demonstrated, Árni Magnússon was deeply involved in reshaping his collection of manuscripts to meet his personal needs and interests. On this slide, you can see one of my favorite graphs from Baker's study, which shows the scale of different types of Árni's interventions into the physical shapes of his manuscripts. He was aggregating texts of various sources into single volumes, he was rearranging the contents of others, and finally dismembering his codices into smaller units. Some of Torfæus' manuscripts ended up among these rearranged manuscripts in the collection of Árni Magnússon. After Árni Magnússon's death in 1730, his collection was bequeathed to the University of Copenhagen, where it was held for over 200 years. At that time, all parts of Torfæus' manuscripts were stored side by side as individual codices in the Arnamagnæan collection, but they were all accessible to the scholarly community in Copenhagen. However, when Iceland became independent from Denmark, first in 1918 and later in 1944, many Icelanders wanted the Icelandic manuscripts held at the University of Copenhagen to be returned to Iceland. The deal was sealed in 1965 when the Danish Parliament decided to divide the collection between Iceland and Denmark. This started the long repatriation process of Icelandic manuscripts to Iceland, which started in 1971 with the arrival of the first manuscripts to Iceland on board of Her Danish Majesty's ship, Veran, on the 21st of April 1971. The process of repatriation of Icelandic manuscripts was completed in 1997, when the last of the manuscripts covered by the agreement was returned to Iceland. Many of Torfæus' manuscripts were sent to Iceland during this period, and they are held today at the Árni Magnússon Institute in Reykjavík. But also, some of them stayed in Denmark, where they are held at the Arnamagnæan Institute in Copenhagen. Because of Árni Magnússon's rearrangement activities and the agreement between Iceland and Denmark about the division of his collection, manuscripts which used to be in a single codex in Torfæus' library today survive in many parts held in two different countries, so that their contents can no longer be seen in their entirety. As the aforementioned manuscript, Codex 16 in folio, now in five parts, two of which are in Copenhagen and three in Reykjavík. This brings me to the last part of my presentation, focused on the reconstruction of the dispersed library of Torfæus. Dispersed libraries are a well-established field of book historical study, with an increasing number of important digital research projects, such as the Digital Bibliotheca Palatina and the Codex Sinaiticus project. While these projects had to almost start their work from scratch and engage specialists in various fields, My individual project builds on the achievements of the existing digital projects. First of all, I'm going to build on the work done by the handread.is team, which is an XML-based manuscript catalog and an image repository for manuscripts held in Denmark and Iceland. If I'm not mistaken, idea for this project was first presented at the Care and Conservation of Manuscripts here in Copenhagen in 1997. And since then, Handrit became one of the most important, if not the most important, tool for research of Icelandic manuscripts that is available online. Another project, whose completion was necessary for a project as mine to begin, is the Digitale Samlinga, or the Digital Collections project. The project was run at the Department of Nordic Studies and Linguistics at the University of Copenhagen, and it includes the repository of digitized photographs of manuscripts held at the Arnamagnæan Institute. These include photos of manuscripts which are not only preserved at the Arnamagnæan collection, but also other repositories where Icelandic manuscripts can be found. Thanks to the data accumulated in these projects, we now have all the necessary means to restore the dispersed manuscripts of Torfæus and to make accessible, for the first time, the library of this internationally important scholar to the wider academic community. A broader understanding of Torfæus's collection will shed light on the origins of inquiry into Old Norse-Icelandic saga literature in Denmark and its important role in conceptualizing national history both in Iceland and in Denmark. The reconstruction will allow us to critically engage with the contents of the collection to answer the research questions highlighted on this slide. So, to what extent did Torfæus's library reflect the sources he used in compiling his historical works? Which of the texts in Torfæus's library are most annotated? And how they relate to other texts preserved in the same reconstructed volume? What can Torfæus's marginal annotations tell us about his principal areas of interest? About his working methods for collecting, rearranging, and annotating manuscripts? And how did these methods impact his interpretation of Old Norse sagas as historical sources? I'm thrilled to announce that these research questions now can be answered thanks to the generous funding I have recently been awarded from the Carlsberg Foundation and the Independent Research Fund, Denmark. Even though I had to choose just one of the fellowships I've been offered, I would like to acknowledge here the great support both funds expressed for the field of Nordic manuscript studies by awarding their funding to this project. If the travel restrictions allow, I'll begin with my project in September this year, and it will be funded by the Carlsberg Foundation and hosted at the University of Oxford. It will be conducted in collaboration with the Arnamagnæan Collection here in Copenhagen and the Schoenberg Institute for Manuscript Studies at the University of Pennsylvania in the United States. I'm really looking forward to this exciting international collaboration, and I hope that next time we see each other physically in Copenhagen in 2023, I will be able to present some of my main findings at the 19th Care and Conservation of Manuscripts. Thank you very much for your attention.